I think my biggest sort of like like thing about Drake is that there's no editing process. It's just like, here is all the music. Have it all. Like, how about we just have like 10% of what you're putting out and 10% of the best stuff, right?
Yeah, because the 10% of the best stuff is amazing. It's,
yeah, and it would still be a lot of music. That's the thing. Like, you know, it's like he's having a competition with Prince. Like, oh yeah, like, you know, Prince would put out, what, 3 albums a year? And this guy's like, I'm going to put out 6 albums a year.
I'm going to put out 1 album and it's going to be like 500 songs long. I love hearing people's Drake feelings. It's great. Trap money, penny. This shit got me in my feelings. Gotta be real with you. Yep. Kiki, do you love me? Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me. Cause I want you and I need you. And I'm down for you always. KB, do you love me? Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me. Cause I want you and I need you.
Welcome to This Broken Mixtape, the podcast that rewinds and presses play on the soundtrack to your life. I'm Jeff Wu.
And I'm Justin Lee.
Music journalist turned digital producer Anupa Mistry has been writing about music and culture for over a decade. Her work has appeared in Pitchfork, Vice, Rolling Stone, New York Mag and Vulture, The Guardian, and The Globe and Mail. In part one of our interview, we talked to Anupa about how she first got into music journalism, the infamous Pitchfork rating system, and going down on a never-ending ASMR YouTube spiral.
Oh, wow.
It's melted.
It's so sensitive. I was in a podcast studio the other day, and someone poured some sparkling water into a glass, and I was like, oh, it sounds so nice.
Man, you know like what? Do you watch Netflix?
Yes.
Okay, so I was, yeah. There's a new thing that came out that's made by the BuzzFeed people.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you see that thing about ASMR? Do you know what that is?
I haven't watched it. Yeah, oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
I have no idea what about like ASMR. It's like, hello, how's it going?
There's a thing on Netflix about that?
Yeah, like, do you know what this phenomenon?
I've heard of it, but is it like a documentary about it? Or
it's like a little, like a, yeah, amazing. Ooh, tingles.
I follow this ASMR woman on Instagram who is like colloquially known as like the pickle lady.
Okay.
She eats pickles into the mic and like she eats like, it's kind of nice because I watched a bunch of ASMR videos and a lot of them are like very conventionally attractive like white woman who, you know, you're like, what is actually going on here in this transaction? Like this weird voyeuristic space.
Have you watched?
I've seen some videos, yeah. Okay. Just because like somebody referenced it, and I was like, "What is this?" So I had to like see for myself, and I was like, "This is so weird." Mm-hmm. I mean, nothing really surprises me on like YouTube anymore, but I was like, "This is kind of a weird thing." I don't know.
Yeah, nothing really does surprise me on YouTube anymore.
Like when you have like Asian people just eating to the point they're gonna blow up, and people pay money to watch them. That's a weird thing. Have you seen that on YouTube? Yeah, like there's like, I mean, I don't mean literally blow up, but like there's, and usually they're
in pain
like,
or something.
No, but usually they're these like really petite women. And they're just eating a shit ton of food.
That's a weird.
Yeah, they're just
thing.
Gorging themselves,
and they're completely like clothed. Like
I don't even think it's about attractiveness.
Yeah, but there's nothing sexual about it. But maybe I mean,
there's a lot of things that aren't that people are still have. You know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This conversation took a turn.
It did. No more music. We're just going to be talking about ASMR and other fetishes. Well, let's get into things.
Yeah.
So joining us, our special guest, is music critic Anupa Mistry. Welcome to the show, Anupa.
Thanks. Thanks for coming to the East End.
No problem. So I mean, I don't know, Jeff, if you've been following. I don't know if you've been following Anupa's work, but I've been following your work for a long time now. And, you know, you're one of my favorite writers.
Thank you.
Write for Pitchfork, The Fader, Globe and Mail. What else am I missing here?
Everywhere.
In the past. Yeah. Anywhere that has some sort of music, pop culture section, you've probably written something for them.
Yeah, basically.
Well, let's start off just from the very beginning of your music journalism career.
Sure.
Or should I just say journalism career? How did you get into journalism first off? And then how did that eventually sort of narrow in on pop culture and music?
I think like a lot of kids in university, I went to school and had no idea what I actually wanted to do. You know, so I was in third year at U of T and I'm like, oh shit, maybe I should start thinking about this. I started out as a biology major, which is kind of crazy. And then I switched to like a poli sci, which was great. But because I didn't know what I wanted to do after, I felt like I had to do more school, which I don't really recommend, especially not journalism school. But yeah, I was good at writing. And I was like, okay, like this seems like a logical next step. I was good at writing. I really threw myself into my political science studies. I really enjoyed learning a lot about the world. And I was like, I'm going to go to J school and be a serious journalist. Mm-hmm. And very quickly after enrolling and arriving, I was like, yeah, I don't think like being a serious reporter is my bag. Mm-hmm. Journalism school, I think, is... some of the training is necessary, but I also think that like you either have natural curiosity and like instincts that you want to follow, or it's just feels like a bit of a placeholder. I really don't like journalism school because I'm like in a shrinking media landscape. It's just like we're just training people and they're sending them out into a world where there's no jobs.
Mm-hmm. Did you go to Ryerson?
No, I went to Humber.
Humber, okay.
Yes, the like... sad little cousin of Ryerson's J.
Well, I went to Ryerson's journalism school and, you know, I have no, well, I shouldn't say I have no complaints about that program, but, you know, it's Humber, I think, is just as great in many ways.
So. Yeah. I mean, like when I got to school, I was like scared of talking to people, like cold calling people. Mm-hmm. And like, I very quickly like got over that. So it's good for things like that. I mean, I think like learning about media ethics and stuff is important. And best practices and that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I thought I wanted to be a serious like political journalist. And then I was like, I don't think I can do this. And I just wanted to write. And so in class, but also like outside of class, I found it really easy to write about something that I really liked, which was music. Mm-hmm. You know, I'd always been like a big music fan, you know, from like when I was a teenager to up until only very recently, I used to go to concerts like all the time. It just seemed like kind of a natural place for me to start. I was like involved in like music communities online, mm-hmm. message boards and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, you got started on like okplayer.com, right?
Yeah.
Which like, I mean, that was my favorite website for the longest time.
It's like for a certain generation of people, that's like the equivalent of street cred or something.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
And then for like other people, it's like, oh, okay, what is that? Well, I guess they've evolved into something that's become even bigger, mm-hmm. but yeah. So that's what it was. It kind of fell into it because it was easy. And then when I graduated and started my first job at like a trade magazine in Toronto, I was like, I want to write about the stuff that I actually want to write about. And so I just started like writing for Exclaim. That grew to like writing for like I Weekly and now RIP I Weekly and mm-hmm. RIP The Grid, mm-hmm. Which came after I Weekly. And that's just, it kind of went from there. It was like, that's where I saw opportunity. That's what I enjoyed writing and reading. Mm-hmm. And I think really why I was successful at it, and I'm part of like a long line of people who written about rap and R&B in the city. Like by no means was I the first, but I think there was a bit of a rising tide, which coincided with like Drake's ascent, mm-hmm. Where people were like, okay, we need to actually start covering this music again and in a more serious way. And I kind of just was there and good at what I do. But I think like, you know, at that point, like, I mean, and even still, like arts criticism in Toronto or arts journalism in Toronto is still really white. The perspective is still really white. Mm-hmm. And I was able to like not only come in and be like, hey, like this is music and scenes that are interesting, but also I think I came from within those spaces too. You know, I wasn't like someone who was just a fan. These are like my friends, or these are people whose shows I've been going to, or people who had been following for a really long time, or friends of friends.
Like I was going to ask you, because you do write a lot about music from Toronto, mm-hmm. do you ever feel like sort of an allegiance to, I mean, bottom line, it's going to be music that you genuinely think is great, but you know, do you feel an allegiance to anyone from Toronto just because you want to rep your city, or?
You mean like to musicians?
Yeah. In terms of just writing favorably. Like, I know that you wouldn't necessarily write, you know, yeah, just because you're trying to help them out or anything like that. But
yeah,
you know, is there that sort of.
No, like the short answer is no. And it, yeah, I mean, I don't really talk about this stuff because people don't ask, but also because, yeah, I guess people don't really know how it works. Mm-hmm. And the landscape has changed. So, you know, I went to J school and was taught very early on, you don't write about your friends. Mm-hmm. And so unless I've been transparent in the piece about it, I've never written about people who are my friends at the time. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people have gone on to become my friends. But for the most part, I don't think I've ever written seriously,
yeah,
about a friend without disclosing. And in fact, I've had to like turn down things because people are like, hey, do you want to interview this person? I'm like, I actually know them. Or, you know, even it comes down to like for the Polaris, I don't vote for records made by my friends,
right?
Which I don't even think is, there was a discussion about it this year. I don't even think it's actually an official rule that you can't advocate for records based on that criteria, but right. I don't know, something about it that feels kind of icky.
Yeah. I mean, you look at like the Grammys and the Oscars, and you know, they're obviously voting for their friends. If you have a vote, you're going to vote for your friend.
Now you make me feel bad. I should have voted for my friend.
But I appreciate that. I mean, I think it's important, especially for something like Polaris, where it's not just a popularity contest, right?
Yeah. I mean, I think it's really hard for people to understand, especially because music writing has changed a lot, and now a lot of people do write about their friends. Mm-hmm. There are people who I've known and I have like casual relationships with who I've totally written about. It's a small city. You like can't avoid bumping into sure. people for sure. But part of the reason why I think it's really important to have that distance is because you want to be able to like write about people and talk about people's work objectively. Mm-hmm. And I think every artist deserves that, actually. You know what I mean? I know that it's kind of hard for people to grasp. Like, people feel kind of sensitive about someone critiquing their work. I wouldn't even call it critiquing. I would say contextualizing. I guess critique, it doesn't really have a negative connotation, but it kind of does mm-hmm. today. I think there's like a lot of value in that. And by that, I don't mean like, so like when I was at Now, for example, I wasn't technically at Now, but when I was contributing really regularly to Now, I think I feel like I had a discussion with my editor at the time, who was Benjamin Bowles, who was great. And I think it came up like, should we like do like a negative review of like some record by like a local artist, or maybe someone had kind of complained or something like that. And it was like, I really, on a level of like local media supporting local artists, like one thing I do believe in is if you don't have something nice to say, then just don't review the record. Mm-hmm. Because mm-hmm. I think especially on a local level, like that kind of feedback can really make or break someone's career, or mm-hmm. not even their career, really their momentum. Mm-hmm. And so I do feel a little bit of fealty to Toronto music in that sense, where if someone's like fledgling and I think they've done something that isn't great, like what does it matter if like I think it's good or not? I can talk about it with my friends, or mm-hmm. I can just not listen to it, you know? Mm-hmm. I don't think that means that you then only write about stuff that you think is excellent or whatever. I think, you know, if you're able to like evaluate something and say, hey, this is a really good effort, then that's totally cool too. But yeah, that's kind of where I stand on it, you know? And I'm, you know, like, I'll write negatively about Drake. Like, it doesn't matter what right. I or anyone from Toronto says about Drake at this point. It's like, so I'm talking about a very different yeah. scale.
At yeah. that level, it's fair game.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, actually, you come to a good point, because Drake is somebody, it's a hard, you know, figure to talk about, because, you know, on one hand, he's done so much for the city's music culture. At the end of the day, I'm always going to support him to a certain extent. Mm. But having said that, to me, like, he's kind of reached his peak a while back. And it's not to say that he can't make interesting music anymore. But it's, to me, like, in the last couple of years has been really, like, I think my biggest sort of, like thing about Drake is that there's no editing process. It's just like, here is all the music. Have it all. Like, how about we just have like 10% of what you're putting out and 10% of the best stuff, right?
Yeah, because the 10% of the best stuff is amazing. It's,
yeah, and it would still be a lot of music. That's the thing. Like, yeah. You know, it's like he's having a competition with Prince. Like, oh yeah, like, you know, Prince would put out, what, 3 albums a year? And this guy's like, oh, I'm going to put out 6 albums a year.
I'm going to put out 1 album and it's going to be like 500 songs long. I love hearing people's Drake feelings. It's great. I kind of think, you know, there was a point where it really felt like he was untouchable in terms of how you could talk about him. And because I think he was producing like a really high level of work. I think there was like a lot of real excitement in the city for like at least psychically what he did for the popular imagination for the city. I think, you know, it depends on who you ask. They'll say he's done a lot or he hasn't done a lot. Mm. I don't think you can argue the fact that he's like done something for the city in the global imagination and locally. Mm. But now it's kind of fun to critique Drake just because people pay attention to that stuff. I like the idea of like offering a counterpoint to people who seem kind of untouchable, except Beyonce and Rihanna.
So no one could say anything bad about either of those two.
Yeah, those are the only ones. Everyone else is fair game.
Well, let's talk. I mean, okay, aside from Drake, you know, let's talk about up and coming people in Toronto. And you know, it doesn't have to be like just hip hop R&B, but yeah. Like name a few that you feel like really deserves the attention right now.
I kind of take issue with the deserving the attention thing.
Okay.
Only because I don't feel as concerned with that right now. And, you know, that's me, like speaking as a burnt out arts journalist, like mm-hmm. I'm like, who cares? Like who's just making good stuff? Mm-hmm. I'm sure these artists would all say that they deserve attention. So, and maybe that's a bit of a disclaimer because I don't want anyone to feel like I'm not shouting them out because I don't feel like they deserve attention. A record I played a lot this year is by Elcon, who is a producer and singer-songwriter from, I think she's from out west actually, but she lives and works here and she owns a studio just north of Toronto. And the record is called Insecurities in Being. And I also found out she's going to be at RBMA next month. She's like one of two Canadian participants, and both of the Canadian participants this year are women, which is pretty rad. Mm-hmm. So her record is really good. It's like really intelligent pop, like folk pop music. And she's, I don't know, I just find the melodies like super catchy, and it's a record you can like sing along to for sure. But it feels like it was made with a lot of care and intention. And so like that's the mood I'm in right now. Mm-hmm. Oh, I don't think she's put out anything recently, but there's a rapper named Sedani who I just really admire her. I think after seeing a lot of shows in my life, the recorded music can be great or good. But if you are like so captivating on stage, like that's the real thing. Mm-hmm. And music can always be improved on, right? And music takes time. Like music, some people don't get great until they're like 10 years, 15 years in. Mm-hmm. Some people come out fully formed. I think Sedani has like a raw talent that is just gonna like go up over the years. Like she's quite young, but on stage, it's like, I just think she's so amazing. So she pals around a lot with like Lido, Pimienta, and who else? Actually, I don't know who she pals around with. I'm blanking on it now. But she's just great. She like is herself on stage. She's a very like Toronto girl. Mm. But her perspective is, I mean, she does hang with Lido. So she's, I think, absorbing and really taking on this mission of like advocating for different kinds of people as part of her stage show. And I think that that's really commendable. Another person who I think is interesting is Casey MQ, who is a producer and singer. And they used to be in a group called Unbuttoned, I believe. But Casey has a song on Elcon's record. So Elcon wrote the song, but Casey performs it on the record. Mm-hmm. And it's just amazing. And they have like a beautiful voice. I just feel like their voice is kind of one of a kind, and I'm excited to see what they're putting out next. So not, I think those three come to top of mind, and I don't think they're what people are expecting.
Yeah,
I've of actually me never, and my taste.
Oh, I've never heard of any of them, and now I'm excited to check them out.
Yeah, I mean, it's not to say that I'm not excited about rapper, traditional R&B, although Sidani's a rapper, but I think my tastes are skewing more towards something that feels a bit more deliberate. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of music in general, I don't think this is endemic to rap or anything like that, but like so much music is being made for fast churn right now. Mm-hmm. And so I'm really interested in like people who stand out from that. Mm-hmm. And those three stand out for me.
So that's something like, I mean, how do you review something like, you know, I know a lot of it is just, you have a choice of whether or not you want to review it, but if someone gives you, say, I don't know, like, let's say Lil Pump drops a new record, and, you know, or somebody that's like, quote unquote, like a SoundCloud rapper. Mm. I don't know how you feel about that kind of hip hop, but like, you know, I imagine you're not a huge fan of it. Just taking a wild guess, because we're kind of from the same generation, and, you know, it's like,
it's totally like, I feel like it's a frequency in young people's ears. Yeah. Where it sounds like Beethoven to them. But like, as soon as you get like past the hump, it just sounds like, I don't even know.
Right.
It's weird because Young Thug just put out a new album. Yeah. And I was listening to it and I was like, I love this. And he's like the godfather of this sound.
But he's one of the few, like, you know, quote unquote, new rappers that I really enjoy.
Yeah.
Like, there's something to him, like his melodies, he does stuff that like no one's ever really tried to do before.
And yeah.
And some of it's like, you know, crazy, but like,
It still works. And so like, this is why I'm like, I refuse to say that like, I don't like any of this new stuff.
Right.
I think there's probably, I haven't spent too much time thinking about it, to be quite honest, but there's probably some level of craftsmanship, or like you said, like his command of melody. Mm-hmm. I think like he's really emotive, which I know a lot of people ascribe to like these young SoundCloud rappers, but I think it's just the nihilism or something that like really freaks me out a little. Mm-hmm. So your question was, if I'm given one of these records, what do I do with it?
Yeah, like it's I mean, you're obviously, as a music critic, you have your own set of biases. Mm. So, you know, can you responsibly review an artist that you just automatically, your predisposition to dislike, possibly?
Well, I think that's the beautiful thing about music criticism, right? Like, mm-hmm. real good music criticism forces you to challenge your own biases and mm-hmm. assumptions. And that's why I think like people need to better understand what it is and recognize good criticism when it shows up. And it's not just negativity, it's context and critique. And it's oftentimes a lot of people challenging mm-hmm. that part of themselves. But to answer your question, I wouldn't review it. Like, to be quite honest, I'm just also like, I don't have the context for it, you know? I don't pay attention to that music in the way that I could. And if it was my job to pay attention to that kind of music, then I would. But like, you know, I've kind of like also pulled away from reviewing a lot. You know, if I was like an arts critic at a newspaper or something like that, then for sure it would be part of my job to pay attention to it. But like, kind of the beauty of moving away from it is that you don't have to have an opinion on everything, like mm-hmm. SoundCloud rap. Now, to be honest, I review a lot of what I have something to say about, which means that I'm not reviewing a lot. But also, it actually does mean that I'm not writing a lot of negative reviews, or I wouldn't say negative. I don't write that much negative reviews. But I'm not writing a lot of, like, I'm not writing about stuff that I don't not care about, mm-hmm. that I don't care about. Yeah, mm-hmm. that's what I mean.
How does it work in terms of, maybe give us some insight? So let's say Pitchfork or mm-hmm. the Fader. I imagine there's certain people that sort of specialize in one genre, or, you know, like, let's give it to Jason because he's done, you know, reviews of the new Young Thug record recently. And and they sort of just, you know, not to say that they're always going to be reviewing the same type of artist, but, you know, I would imagine that the editor would know, you know, their strong suits. So how does that work? Is it just that based on what you've reviewed in the past, that's what they're sort of going to pass?
Yeah, I mean, it's a mixed bag, right? Like, everyone works differently. I feel like for a time, like, especially when I was younger and Yeah, when I was younger and was like maybe a different voice in the landscape, like I was just getting assigned a lot of rap and R&B like automatically. And I mean, I wasn't saying no to work, but also it was frustrating because I was like, can I like review the Feist record? Like, yeah. I love Feist. Yeah, I think now it is. Okay, so as someone who, you know, I was an editor at the Fader, and so we would have these discussions. Okay, this record is coming out. Do we want to publish like an essay review of this? Who would be the right person? And I think it's, from my experience, it's always been like, who's a reliable and capable writer, first of all, who's going to deliver on like a short-term deadline, and who's going to deliver something that we can like get out like reasonably quickly. I mean, obviously the stuff is edited and checked and that kind of thing, but there's like that kind of like baseline, like just reliability factor. Mm-hmm. And then it's also like, you know, we used to cast, oh, that's such a terrible word, but yeah, I mean, we used to be like, okay, like we'd reach out to people like, do you have an opinion on this, even like an interesting take on this? Not because you can't also, you also don't want to publish something that reads kind of middling either, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So that was like totally a factor. And then sometimes like, I'm sure people get asked to review records based on like their tweets and stuff like that. I mean, I've been, I suppose, I can't think of like a specific example, but I'm sure that like I've tweeted some stupid opinion about something. And then the next day someone's been like, hey, do you want to write about this record? And mm-hmm. yeah. So it's a mixture of things, but I think like, I would say that for most people, it's probably definitely a like reliability thing. Like, can you turn around something that is like worth reading, that feels substantive, and like, can you do it on deadline? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. How about in the case of like, say a Pitchfork where there's a you know, a numerical rating assigned, is that up to the writer to come up with that? Is it the editor? How does that work?
Yeah. I don't know if I'm like revealing the sauce. I think it's like openly known that like writers don't choose the number, the numerical rating. I mean, like for me, my mind doesn't even work that way. So I like could never even ballpark that. Like whenever I used to write a review for Pitchfork, like I never sent in a number.
Right.
And I never cared what the number was. Mm-hmm. I know it means things to people. I don't really understand it, especially when it's that specific, like 7.2. Like, yeah. What does that even mean?
Exactly.
You know? Yeah. So yeah, unless they've changed things, from what I know, it's like an internal decision that probably is like, I mean, I don't know. Like, I don't know actually what they make their decision, what they base their decision making on. Like, they're owned by Condé Nast now. Like, mm-hmm. I don't know if there's like corporate influences there in terms of like putting out a favorable number or not. I don't know if it's like, you know, like assigning something a high number that people have low expectations for, or a low number that people have high expectations for. I don't know if that's like a way of like generating clickbait. I'm sure like a big part of it is reading the review and trying to like distill the review into a number or something like that. But
well, especially in the case of Pitchfork, I think it means a lot to the musician because it could really have a huge impact on their career, right?
Like, yeah.
if something is voted best new music, they're going to sell probably more tickets, you know, like if they're a relatively unknown band, right?
I didn't realize this, but you know, some of the stuff I'm like, I don't know if this is like industry, like not public things that you're like, things that you're not supposed to say, but I reviewed a record by Zaki Ibrahim earlier this year. That was the last thing I think I wrote for Pitchfork. Let's talk about an art, like kind of going back to what you're saying about like, do you feel like an allegiance to Toronto artists? I feel an allegiance to people who've been putting out like work for a long time and are continually besting themselves, which I feel like Zaki has done. You know, like that album is to me incredible, also one of my favorite albums of this year, and that's why I wrote about it, because I was like, here's someone who's been grinding forever and like the quality has like not stopped. In fact, she's like just putting out important work. But and she's just like, she doesn't really have too much of like a media profile outside of Toronto and South Africa, where she's worked for a really long time, and that was her first ever Pitchfork mention in like what, 10-year plus career. Mm-hmm. I believe in that kind of stuff also as an act of like documenting like these people, especially if they've put in the work for that long. It's like, I mean, I wasn't thinking when I asked to review it, I wasn't thinking like, hey, like I'm going to go in with all these noble means. I was like, this is interesting. I have something to say about it, whatever. But I found out like afterwards that she got like festival bookings in Europe and like things materialized mm-hmm. for her based on that review. And I think it got like a 7.8, which I don't know what that means.
Yeah.
But I tried to write something about her and like make a bigger statement about something that I felt was important. And I guess that matter. mm-hmm. It's weird because sometimes you just like you push out these reviews and you're like, who's reading them? Like, does it even matter? And that's like for me, like, and that's 10 years into this. 10 years in, finally someone's like telling me, hey, you did this thing, and like this is the tangible effect that it had. That was important for me to hear. I didn't know that, for you know. Sure.
But when you read that review, it doesn't seem like a 7.8 rating. You know, again, like
what
I know
is it,
it's,
what does it mean?
It
like
seems to? Higher than that. I don't know. I would think 8.2. I would say it's at least in the low eights, like 8.2, 8.3.
Sure, but I don't know. I mean, who knows what goes into this? Maybe for them, they're like, this is someone who not a lot of people know. So why would we rank? I don't know. You know, like.
Yeah, that's
right. There's a conversation somewhere where people are talking about this. It's like, and you know, maybe the 8.2 got downloaded to the 7.8.
Well, I know that something like 10 years ago, some guy wrote an entire thesis about Pitchfork's rating system. He did, you know.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was. I don't know what he was getting like his PhD in, but he wrote this, you know, his doctorate in like actually approached it from a mathematical stance. And I didn't read the whole thing, but it was well publicized within like the music community. So it's interesting. I don't know.
Look that up. And you know what would be amazing is if he did his same study now, because the range of music, and I think there's like probably more of an impetus to give higher reviews. I think probably 10 years ago they were like giving, like they were being very like music snob, mm-hmm. you know, 10 mm-hmm. years plus. Mm-hmm. And I think they've kind of become more generous in their ratings.
You've been listening to season 2, episode 18 of This Broken Mixtape. Part 1 of 2 with our special guest, music journalist turned digital producer, Anupa Mistry. If you haven't already, visit thisbrokenmixtape.com to check out this episode's Spotify playlist. There you'll also find our past interviews and custom illustrations for each show. If you enjoyed this episode, please take the time to subscribe, rate, and share our podcast however you're tuning into us today. That'd be really amazing, and we'd really appreciate the added boost. Also, if you have any questions, comments, feedback, or ideas for guests, feel free to drop us a line through our website, Instagram, or Twitter. You can find all of our episodes on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and the Buns Podcast Network, and now, Spotify. Join us back next week for part 2 of our conversation with Anupa Mistry. As always, thank you for listening. We really appreciate it. Cheers.